Dude, we gotta fucking write something new. Come on.
I don't like that. So far, off to a bad start. Better, closer, warmer. And that's it. Okay.
The revs start to build here for GP260 series at Iowa, and we are away. But all I can think about is kielbasa and sausage, your butt cheeks is warm. I check my distance, you need lubrication, honey. My kielbasa sausage has just got to perform. Now get it on.
I think we just seen Colin kiss the barrier as he came out the last corner there. I think that might be Velkov. I think he's just moved his engine going into the first corner.
Hold it round the outside, but a little bit loose, side by side. Yeah. Congratulations, Nenad. Fantastic victory, pole position, fastest lap of the race. Good evening, everybody. Welcome to ARL-TV for this round 7 of the GP260 series, coming to you live from Okayama. I'm Alex Simpson, and I'm joined today in the commentary booth with Ryan Littlemore. We saw Ryan at Spa with the V8, so it's nice to have you back in the commentary booth, Ryan.
Hey, Alex, and good evening, everyone. Yeah, it's good to be back, and hopefully tonight, as we saw in the V8 a couple of weeks ago, hopefully we can have a good cracking race here in Okayama.
Yeah, we've got about 8 minutes of qualifying left, but we'll touch base on that shortly and give the guys a bit of an overview of how things are panning out. But just thought we'd have a little look at the championship tables as they stand. And out front, as anybody who's been following the series will know, Tony Repussard, obviously 5 victories out of 6 races, fantastic start, but first time he didn't capture that top spot of the podium last week. Nenad Matijevic managed to get that, and he solidated his position in second place. Third, you've got Marco Montaldo and Daniel Lopez, who missed out last week, as a few drivers did. It's a tricky track, and not a lot of people have got the oval circuit. So, but Daniel still finds himself in fourth, and the unlucky Peter Velkov in fifth place. Arguably, somebody who could have been right up there fighting Tony with out his nightmare races that he's had. Just having a quick look at the Constructors' Championship. Trident Racing sitting up the top there. John Alec, Tony Repussard, 161 points, absolutely flying, but still with a chance. I think Venezuela GP, well, we're not even halfway through the season yet, 111 points. I definitely feel those guys can get themselves back in it. Rapax with Nenad Matijevic and Trevor Longman as well, 86 points. Racing Engineering is Hugo Pretcher and Daniel Lopez. It's fair to say Daniel's done most of the, in fact he's done all the point scoring there, so hopefully he can get Hugo onto the into the point finishes and help him progress, get up that Constructors Championship table. But how's qualifying looking at the moment, Ryan?
Well, currently we have Tony Repussard currently on pole position with a 25 flat, with Peter Velkov just 0.2 behind him, and then we have Daniel Lopez another 0.1 back from Peter. Then we're in fourth place, we have Jan Lapchin, who is on a 25.5. This is going to be a hard one. Joel Rodriguez, I think I've got that right. He's about 0.08 behind Jan. And I'm just watching here, Colin Cunniff, I think it is, who's done a 25.6. John Allert and Marco in 7th and 8th, with Paul and Nenad completing the top 10. We have Lee Thompson in 11th place with a 25.9, he's just got that, so he's improved on his previous best. Charlie Shears, who's in 12th place with Wojciech Rab, that's a very bizarre name, I can't really pronounce that.
Yeah, Wojciech Rabstein, I think. Wojciech Rabstein?
Something like
Wojciech. I'm sorry, I do apologise. We will, you know. I think we've apologised every week for not getting someone's name right, so why make this week any different?
we'll go Wojciech. He's 13th, with Justin in 14th place, with Aramon in 15th. And 16th and last place, we have Yoho Pinho with a 26.7. And we have exactly 5 minutes to go in qualifying.
Yeah, definitely a few drivers who I think are going to progress up the field. Justin and Yao certainly going to get themselves up there, I feel. So you can have a little look. I'm just on board now with Daniel Lopez, as he looks like he's on the lap. Let's just have a quick look. Actually, as the camera flips away. Typical iRacing fashion, over to Jan Lapchin.
Yeah, I'm just currently watching the pole sitter at the minute, Tony Repussard, and I'm just wondering, Alex, if you could ask me this, about the difference, because obviously you know that I compete in F1. What's the difference between these and the Star Mazdas that we are seeing here tonight?
Yeah, well, the Star Mazda obviously is an aero-based single-seater car, so the principles are fairly similar. The main difference, obviously, is a lot less horsepower, but also a lot less aero grip as well. I think these are... Someone's probably going to shout at me for getting this wrong, but we called the series 260 because there should be 260 brake horsepower, but I think when we researched it, it was slightly different. It might be the newer version. I'm not 100% sure that's 270 or something like that. But yeah, about 260 brake horsepower out of these. And I'd probably say about 30% of the downforce levels that you'd get in an F1 car. But like I say, the principles are pretty much the same. You'd sort of drive it very, very similar. These have a little bit more off-power oversteer than you get with the F1. The back end a lot more stable on entry on an F1 car than this. But these cars definitely have a lot more stable on the exits due to the reduced amount of power. So similar techniques to driving them. A lot of drivers you find sort of use this car as the feeder to jump into the FW31. So see a lot of good drivers here. I mean, we've got some fantastic drivers in this field, as our viewers will know.
Yep, and I'm just currently on board with Colin here, who's done in sixth place. And one thing I've been watching recently on here during practice is traffic again. There is a bit. Some drivers are all sticking together. Maybe the teammates are working together to get some slipstream like the old Alonso Massa strategy from Monza, but it's going to be interesting. Maybe team orders might be brought in here as we're approaching the half distance of the season. We'll just have to wait and see, won't we?
Yeah, I mean it's difficult to say. I mean, there's obviously a lot on the line. There's quite a few prizes up for grabs. Obviously, there's some credits available for the drivers who win, and it's top five and Constructors Champions as well, and there's prize draws available for just participation and things like that. So There's quite a lot up for grabs for being the quickest driver, but also just competing. So a lot of the drivers will turn up and compete, enjoy racing. But you don't necessarily have to be the quickest to win the prizes at the end of the season, which is a good thing and keeps people coming back. Although, that said, I think we are looking to inject a few new drivers in at the halfway point after Watkins Glen.
As I'm now on board with Liam, and who's recently, I think, joined Apex Racing UK. He's a hot prospect, I think. He's very quick in the Star Mazda from watching previous races from the stream. And also we have Lee Thompson, another Apex Racing UK driver. And these guys are one, I think, for me, in my opinion, for tonight, they could be the ones to watch out for in this race. What do you think, Alex?
Well, I would like to agree and hope that they're going to do well. I definitely wish Lee all the best, because he's not feeling very well at the moment. So he came in with a serious case of man flu earlier on. So, you know, I hope he can stay concentrating for the whole race and he gets a good result. He's been caught up in pretty much every incident there is possible this season in Turn 1. None of his doing, so... Yeah, I hope he has a better race this week. And same for Williams as well. He's been quite unlucky and he scored some points, got some top 10 finishes, but definitely feel that he could repeat that again and get some points on the board. I mean, my personal vouch, I think there's going to be a great battle between Peter Velkov, Tony Repussard, Daniel Lopez, Nenad, Matijevic. Every week those guys seem to be separated by just a few tenths of a second and always produce great battles. So I'd like to see Peter take the checkered flag today, but it's not going to happen now because he's it's commentator's curse. But yeah, he's definitely had some rotten luck, and I want to see him break that duck and get on the top spot of the podium.
Yeah, as the qualifying session is over, but we've got some drivers still on their last laps, and Liam's about to cross the finish line. And has he improved? No, he hasn't. He hasn't improved. He's only 1/1000th of a second down on his previous best time, so he didn't really gain anything from that. As onto road check now, as he crosses the finish line, but he's doing a bit of maybe he's warming his tyres up for the race, possibly.
Yeah, but just having a quick look at the grid now as everybody's coming across. We've got Tony Repussard broke into the 124s with a 24.984. Fantastic lap there. Peter Velkov in second place. As I said, those guys separated by about 0.2 of a second. Daniel Lopez right on the heels of Peter. Jan Lapchin, he's really shown that he's definitely got the stuff to compete at the top end. 25.2 as well. Colin Cunniff, another good driver, 25.4. Jao Rodriguez, 25.5, Marco Montalno in 7th place, John Aller in 8th, Paul Nilsson in 9th, and Nenad Matijevic in 10th. Nenad down there a little bit. He jumped in quite late in the session, give us a little scare, so perhaps he was, just hasn't warmed up enough there. Lee Thompson in 11th, good result for Lee, 25.8. He said he could get a 25, and he has done. That's nice, improved on that earlier time of the 0.9. Charles Sears, 26 dead. Justin Lindsay, 26.2. Wojciech Rebstein, 26.3. Jao Pinho, 15th, 26.4. It's such a tight grid, actually, looking at this. Liam Williams, Aaron Mullen. Fantastic qualifying, really. That's quite close, covering the whole field there.
Yeah, as we can see now, the drivers are making their way onto the grid for, I believe it is, 31 laps around this track. As I think we're just waiting for two more drivers, I think, but gonna be an interesting one. I'm not sure about strategy here for fuel and tyres, but have to wait and see what's gonna happen. I think it's a one stopper, I think.
Yeah, the guys are only gonna be doing the one stop, I feel. Whether anyone will decide to take tyres or not, I'm not 100% sure. I highly doubt it, if I'm honest. Seems to be the way of things for the season so far.
Good work, everyone.
As we are just waiting for one more driver, I think it is. Oh, and he's just popped up on the grid there. Who that is? Peter Velkov, who's just popped on, so he's just made the grid. Otherwise, he would have started from the pit lane. And you don't want to do that if you start if you had a good qualifying session, because I've done it before, and it's not great. As I think everyone's on the grid now, and the light should be coming any time now.
Green, green, green!
Yeah, and we're away here. Okayama, round 7, GP260 series. Everybody into the first corner, looks tight there. Matijevic, looks like he's got stuck in between some cars.
Very clean start, I have to say. Very impressed with the driving here from all the 17 drivers here. As Marco is round the outside of the number 12 car. As we've got a little bit of contact there at the hairpin, I don't know who it was, because
I hate to say it's either Aaron or Lee, one of the drivers there, not sure who, I hope.
I think it was Lee. Just Lee.
How that guy can have so much poor luck, I do not know.
No, we'll have to check, we'll have to look at the replays at that. It's a shame I was on him, and then iRacing decides to change the view, which is the one thing I hate about iRacing, but it's a shame for Lee. That happens in racing. That does, and it's apparently been taken out. But hopefully, we can look at the replay of that.
Yeah, the way the administration system works, obviously, everything's done post-race now, and time penalties are issued. So the admins will have a look at that if Lee decides to submit something.
Yep, as I'm on the number 20 car of yellow, Rodriguez, who's slightly under pressure. Yeah, I mean, he's got a couple of cars behind him in the slipstream, and obviously this is going to be the key area for an overtake, as he's defending pretty well, I have to say, from the number 17 car.
Yeah, Jao there. I think that's Matijevic behind him, and we know how quick he can be. Obviously, last week's winner at Iowa Road, so he'll definitely be looking to work his way up through the pack. Matijevic has got Giles Pete, teammate behind him, is in Marco Montaldo, Venezuelan GP there. So probably the lowest I've seen those guys. So I expect them to work their way up. Such well, a tight field though today.
I was just going to say, they could possibly be doing some fuel saving at this point. There's a possibility, I don't know, but also tyres as well. These guys are going to be not pitting for no tyres, and it may be wise to start doing it now. As you can see, number 8 car is going around the inside, but yeah, he loses the position.
That's Repussard there, coming under a lot of pressure. I think Velkov got himself through there. Didn't see anything on the first lap where he got through, but Velkov takes the lead. It looked like Lopez was going to follow through, but Tony just about held it around the outside and then had the inside for the switchback corner.
I believe as well, I noticed slightly that Yellow and Wojciech, number 37 car, made contact at the hairpin as well. Didn't see much of it, but I did notice something in the chat box that there was contact made. Hopefully that might be taken to the stewards after the race.
Did Yao drop back, or is he still on? Are they still on track?
I think he's still on track. I believe.
I can see him in the screen actually.
It's pretty.
I don't see Wojciech though. That's somebody I do.
He's dropped to 14th place. He's dropped way down the order. Yo's in the pits. Gone into the pit then. He's got damage, I believe. As there's nothing to separate the top five here. They're all separated by 1.5 seconds. And Peter Volkov is not pulling away as much as I was expecting him to be, considering his impressive qualifying time that he set moments ago. But the likes of Tony, Daniel Lopez, Jan Lapchin, and Tony Repussard are keeping up with him. And Peter may be vulnerable to an attack from these three drivers.
Yeah, well, we only saw about half a second between the top sort of 10 on the field here in qualifying. So I think with the added slipstream effect that the guys are going to get, we're going to see a very, very close race. And I think pit stop strategy is going to definitely play out. We've seen this before in some of the other races like Lime Rock Park this season. where drivers have gone in late and managed to jump a few people, and others that have gone in early. So let's see if somebody decides to jump out of the mire that's this battle and tries to get some clean laps in.
Just seeing here, Tony Repussard is looking like he's going to make a move here into the hairpin. He's got the inside. Is he going to make the move stick? I think he has.
Oh, they're side by side. Peter's got the line covered though for this corner. Has indeed. Lapchin having a look on Lopez. Lopez waiting to see what happens between these two.
He's gone a bit wide, and Lopez, he looked like he was going to attempt a move there, but he decided to take the safe option and back out of it. But he's right under pressure here from Jan Lapchin, as you said. And it looks like these guys... Oh, and I think we just had some contact there.
Just a little bit of rub in there. I think everybody survived that. Everybody's okay. Can't see any damage front wing, so I think everyone's got away with that one. It's so close. I think that's Rodriguez behind Colin Cunniff there as well. There's nothing separating these guys.
Oh, this is brilliant. This is what racing is all about. Close racing, excellent driving from all of these drivers here in the top five.
Yeah, I think we've got Rodriguez there, who's got himself past Cunniff. Oh, sideways. Whoa. Onto the gravel. Yeah. Even Matijevic got through, and I think his Rodriguez teammate's gone through as well.
Yeah, I was just about to say as well, Jan Lapchin as well at the same corner did the same thing. He lost the back end and he was drifting coming out of that corner. But luckily enough, he has kept the car in a straight line, and fair credit to him.
Yeah, Rodriguez still under a lot of pressure here. Nelson looking racy, got a little bit of slipstream. Can't. He's going to have to go the long way around. Yep, doesn't manage it, tucks back in.
I've just jumped on board with Rodriguez, and he's on the back now of Codden here, as he's about, I believe, about 3 tenths behind Codden at this point. And off camera, Lopez has lost third position to Jan Lapchin. He's gone down to fourth place now. Wonder what happened there. He might have made a mistake, might have gone wide.
It was ridiculously close the previous lap where we heard that bit of contact, and I wonder if he got a run going down this main straight. So I'll see if I can find that overtake in a moment.
The gap, Peter Velkov is only still 3 tenths ahead of Tony Repussard, but the two of them have pulled away from the rest of the pack here. The gap between Peter and Jan Lapchin, who's in third place, is now 1.8 seconds. But really, I think it's going to be rough. These guys are on the same pace, on race pace here. But you never know. Jan Lapchin is a very quick driver, and so is Daniel Lopez. So probably these guys can probably catch up, and hopefully we can have a four-way battle like we saw in the first opening two laps.
Yeah, just watching the overtake now, actually, just as we saw, we were distracted with Rodriguez and everything. I think Lapchin got the run on Lopez. Actually, just looking at it, I think Lopez just went a little bit wide. Lapchin side by side, coming out of the hairpin, and then Lopez just lost the back end a little bit. That let Lapchin through. So more of a pressure move than anything there.
Yep, and Rodriguez has just gone onto the grass. He hasn't really lost as much time there. He's only lost really about 2 tenths from the car in front, but it's going to be very interesting to see how Rodriguez does, if he's got a lot of pressure from Paul Nielsen. Is just slowly gaining on him by about 2 tenths on that last lap, as we have a spinner. I believe
looks
that's
like Colin Cunniff there, spinning out. Seems to have recovered it, but it's going to set him back a little bit there.
Yeah, I was just about to say, I think Colin went a bit too wide and had his left rear tyre onto the gravel. And obviously if that happens and you put a lot of throttle down, you will lose the back end. And sad to say, he lost it. And I think he's dropping down the order. He may be maybe in 13th or 14th place.
Just as we hear some team chat there.
Yeah, that's from Charlie. Doria says, who is in the 15th place. He's about 40 seconds off the lead after I think he had some problems at the start. maybe had some contact with the driver, I'm not really entirely sure. But there's a good little squabble here between Rodriguez, Colin, it's not Colin anymore because obviously he spun it, but Rodriguez, Montaldo, and Nenad, I think I've got that right. But
yep, Nenad.
Yeah, I think these guys, it's about, roughly about about 1.5 seconds between these three. Yeah, as I think Rodriguez did make a big mistake there. I think he took a bit too much curb at the final corner, what I can see. But the gap is still between Peter Velkov and Tony Repussard, still 3 tenths. So these guys are setting equal pace here, which is really good to see. And we could have a really good battle between these two if one of them makes a mistake, especially if it's Velkov, as Repussard's giving him a lot of pressure and he's hoping that Peter can make a mistake.
Yeah, Lapchin just trying to hold on to these guys as well, where they, both him and Daniel, they had that battling lap, managed to lose a little bit of time, perhaps a little bit of draft there. Just both drivers hoping these two squabble in front of them a little bit so they can latch back onto them.
Yep, and Yolo has retired from the race. He's two laps down and he's decided to make the journey back home.
Pino must have had some terminal damage there then.
Yeah, as I've just jumped on board with, sorry Alex, I'm just watching Liam, and he's only about half a second behind Colin here, who's trying to recover from his spin that we saw on at turn one. And I think Liam, he's saying 27 flats at the minute is his best time, and it's really good race pace for that, to get some grip into the tyres, get some more grip. As in front, Colin just made a slight mistake there coming out of the hairpin, he's probably lost a bit of time, but don't count these guys who are in like 10th to I believe 13th place, because they're only roughly about 13 seconds off the lead. So if these guys are not going to be pitting this race, and obviously the front runners do, then these could be in for a possible podium shout here.
Yeah, I know the fuel is particularly, cars are particularly on the fuel round here, but I don't honestly think that they can make it. I think the fuel restrictions that we've got in place in the series, where we're restricting 20% fuel, I believe it's going to force everybody in. But Williams' teammate, Lindsay, obviously another ARUK driver, doing well, just sitting at the back of this little pack.
As I've just jumped on board with Martaldo, as he's still in touch with Nenad, and he's got Rodriguez behind him as well, so he's not in the best comfortable position of the three drivers, as he's trying to get past the car in front, but he's also got a car behind as well, so he's got to keep his eyes on the mirrors from behind. And also,
it's tricky for Rodriguez, I think. Obviously he's got his teammate in front of him, he was obviously there, but he made a little bit of mistake, and actually he just has a little wobble coming off there. Nelson might get the run as we see it in the background, just as the camera jumps onto this lead battle once again. Repussard getting ridiculously close through turn one.
Yep, I've just jumped on onto the cockpit view, and it's very, very close here between these two drivers. They've not really both from Jan Lapchin. He was the quicker of the top three drivers by about 0.2 of a second, and he's got the gap now to just a second now, which is very interesting, as Jan's slowly gaining it. Daniel Lopez as well, he's gaining time on these two drivers as well that we're seeing on the screen. He gained about 0.2 as well, and he's only 1.8 seconds behind these three drivers here. But as you can see there, Tony's really on the back now of Peter Velkov. He's just waiting for Velkov to make a mistake here.
Yeah, unfortunately Peter has been prone to the odd mistake this season as well, and Tony will know that in the back of his head, and he'll just want us to keep within that second, try and almost keep it into half a second as the gap, and then the pressure's really on Peter. And you know, like I said earlier on, he has made a few mistakes, so let's hope he can suck it up. I would like to see Peter hold on to this one, but with strategies, who knows how this is going to pan out.
But, and as we see, sorry to interrupt, actually, Yoel Rodriguez has gone into the pit lane.
I would think that's probably tactical. Rodriguez knows that he can't really make a move on his teammate, doesn't want to affect his race, so he's getting himself in now. He can make it to the end now on with the fuel, so gets himself in, he gets some clean air, he can try and undercut the two drivers that are in front of him, and safely get past his teammate as well.
I think, off camera, he might have made a mistake as Paul Nielsen, the 23 car, was caught up dramatically, and he was about 2 tenths behind Rodriguez before he pitted, and it looked like Paul was going to make a move before the fast right-hander, where the pit lane entry is. But yeah, Paul is up 7th place now, and he's not that far from the leaders, he's only 7 seconds behind, so if he plays it right here, he could be in with a shout podium here.
Yeah, I mean, the top four seem to be pulling away, I would say, from the rest of the pack now. Earlier on, it was obviously very much nose to tail, the whole pack, but seems this top four seem to be pulling away. But like you say, Tony there, having a little look, Velkov.
Oh, he's right on the back there, right on his diffuser there. Oh, this is brilliant. This is what we want to see. But Tony's giving it everything, the setup that he's got for this one. He's pushing it to the limit here.
Yeah, Velkov didn't look like he had a very good exit there. Tony's got a run, has a little look, can't make it in. It's more the back. Gets a lot of tighter line. I thought for a minute he was just going to try and sneak a wing or up the inside.
Yeah, as I'm just jumping the ball with Jan Lapchin, and he's gaining on these two here as they're squabbling for the lead. And Jan's going to join the party here, and he's just waiting for these two to make a mistake. As I've just jumped back on board with Tony Rep, right on the back of him now, and he could get a move here if he stays in the slipstream of the Velkov here.
Yeah, as we see, he just comes down this back straight. He's got a little bit longer, this back straight is, than the main straight. So he has a little look, comes out under braking. Peter, I think he's... Oh, there's contact, but nothing going there. That was ever so lucky. Could have easily been broken wings, spun cars.
Yeah.
Tony gets a little bit loose. Lapchin catches up.
Right on the back of Tony Repussard. Now, Repussard's going to be thinking he doesn't want to lose a position here to Jan Lapchin, and he wants to take the lead here from Velkov. Just a fact as well, Repussard was the fastest of the two drivers of Velkov and himself by about a tenth. As we see, Velkov's in the pit lane. This could be a tactic move here, possibly. But I think these guys are struggling now with tyres, I think. Repussard's just struggling. He had a really bad exit coming out of the final corner there. Yeah, sorry, Alex.
Yeah, I was just going to say exactly the same thing. Lapchin coming under pressure there from Lopez. Tony now with clean air in front of him, so we'll see if he set that fantastic time, but gets a whole load of gravel there. Perhaps that's a new ploy, kicking that up, just trying to put Lapchin off.
Lapchin's in the slipstream, yeah, and he's gained ever so slightly. And as you said, Lopez is right on the back of Lapchin now, and this could be very interesting to see how Lopez plays this out. And could he just wait until these guys make a mistake, as these guys are right on the back of each other now. This is exciting to see these three squabbling out here for the lead, and to think as well, to consider as well.
You lost it there, haven't you?
I've lost it. I can't think who was leading, and he went in the pit there.
Peter Velkov, yeah.
That was it, Velkov. But Velkov's thinking, let's pit early. Let these three have a squabble. They could lose time, and he could gain time during this stint.
Well, that's the thing, he's not under pressure now as well, is he? He's only on pressure on the clock when he comes out, so he knows that he's just got to bang the laps in. He hasn't got to worry about defending to Tony, so perhaps there's some strategical thinking on his part there. But yeah, let's see how that one pans out, though.
Yeah, I was just saying, if he's a squabbling, you can get him maybe 3-4 seconds, and then he could jump all these drivers in front of him. But I would have suspected that these guys would have pitted straight away, like making a response to the pit stop of Velkov. But these guys are staying out, and I think these guys are pretty confident on the tyres. They're doing a Sergio Perez here.
Yeah.
Tyre saving. Lapchin's only about 3 tenths behind Repussard now, and Lopez is, I think he's on the slipstream of Lapchin.
Yeah, these guys are closing up. You can still see in the background Nenad and Montaldo, so they're not out of it yet, but I do think they're going to have to pick the pace up if they're going to get a top four.
And Repussard went wide at the hairpin, and Lapchin was going to make a move, but he did the safe option and decided to back out. So it was great driving from Lapchin. But I think Repussard has to pit. He is really struggling now. I think his rear tyre's gotten these a little bit of a sideways moment at the hairpin. Lapchin's just waiting for an opportunist move here.
I was just looking at Peter's pit stop there as well, and he didn't take any tyres, so he feels comfortable with the tyres that are on there, and they should last the distance. So I think the loose setup that we're seeing there is just what we get from Tony and his setups. They are always very, very loose and slippery. Seems to get the best out of them. But it does always look like he's thrashing the pants off of it, and it's on the ragged edge.
Yeah, because I'm just going to jump on board with Peter Velkov. I think he's just got past Aaron Mullen, I think. I think he got past him on that lap. So Peter Velkov is making a charge now. He's going to, hopefully, as he's got clean air, I think he's about 10 seconds from the next car up the road, which is Liam Williams, as Aaron has just been taken by the number 37 car at turn one. It was a good move there, I have to say.
Yeah, just caught that in the back there, actually. Looking at Velkov's last lap, it was a 126.3 compared to 25.9 from Repussard. So I don't think this strategy's working at the moment. He's going to need to pick this pace up.
Most definitely. But the only advantage he has is the open on the track. He's got 10 seconds, or he's 10 seconds behind Liam Williams, who's the next car in front. So if he can just set constant lap times and have Lapchin and
Lopez coming into the pits, just yep, about keeps it inside the pit lane limits there.
Yep, and Repussard went a bit wide coming out the final corner, but he touched had a bit of gravel, and Nenad has done the same as well, and he's just lost a bit of time from this pack. He's only about 4 seconds from this lap, and he just lost a second. But I've just gone on board with Mark now, 82 car, and he's closing in on Nenad now, and possibly Nenad might have to pit, because I did watch him a past couple of laps, and he is struggling in the slow corner, so possibly his tyres are slow raiding, and we don't really want to see that. Well, on his side, of his perspective, and Marco is now really close now.
Yeah, Marco just about getting a little bit of slipstream where he is now.
Just gonna jump on board with Daniel Lopez and see if he's got out ahead of Peter Velkov. I think he has. I think he's ahead by about maybe half.
No, I don't think he is, actually. I think Velkov. Velkov is about. He's probably gained a few tenths of a second over Lopez there, so. And actually, yeah, just looking at the pit stop times as well, Velkov 7.4 seconds in the pits, Lopez 9 seconds, so you know, nearly 2 seconds, 1.6 seconds lost in the pits there, so this could give us an idea roughly of where the other drivers are going to come out. Velkov might just hold on to this, but it's going to be extremely close.
It certainly will, and if these guys are still Tony Repussard and second place of Jan Lapchin, if these guys are staying out and if the tyres are going, then possibly you could the bold strategy by Peter Velkov could possibly work here in his favour if these guys stay out for another 3 to 4 laps. But the gap is still the same. It's about 8 tenths now, so Repussard's pulling away ever so slightly from Jan Lapchin, as Repussard set a 25.8 that last time. So he's
Velkov 25.8 as well. So his punch and counter punch here. It's I'm sure they've got their spotters in the background just telling them what sort of lap times they need to be doing. It was important for Velkov that the three drivers carried on battling, and that didn't really happen. They've sort of gone single file, and no one's really stuck their nose in there since that Velkov's gone in. So. It's going to be close. I'm looking forward to seeing when they're going to come in. It looks like they're going to run a very long first stint as well. So just keep an eye on the lap times.
I'm just on board with Daniel Lopez here, and he's in 8th place, and he's got some pressure from the number 37 car here. He's only about 6 tenths behind Lopez, so Lopez could be in a bit of a bother here. and he doesn't really want to be battling with a slower car, and Velkov is slowly pulling away. He's 4 seconds up the road from Lopez, so Lopez is obviously the big loser from the pit stop phase so far.
Yeah, Wojciech is going to need to pit. I think he hasn't yet, so while Lopez is under a little bit of pressure, I don't think that's going to last forever. And actually looking at it, he looks like he's got a little bit of wing damage on the front of that Lotus GP260 car.
Yep, as just jumped back to the top two here, and it's still 7 tenths between Tony Repussard and Lapchin. And I think Repussard went a bit wide coming out of the exit of the double left hander there, but
he could just about get away with that. I mean, in some of the F1 practice, just only turned a few laps there, but I think you can get away with that even in that car, and that's way more susceptible to the bumps than this is. So. And it looks like Lopez in Lapchin's going to go longer than everyone, so
yep, as
let's keep going to jump on board with Velkov really quickly here, just to see where he is, and if you can pin out, he's just going down the back straight now. It's such a long time. It was about, I think the whole pit stop phase was about 24 seconds.
Off camera, Lee Thompson's just made a move on Aaron McMullen up to 15th place. It was a good move there from Lee, who's slowly trying to get his back way into this race after what happened on the first lap. And I think Aaron moved a bit wide a bit, and Lee got the inside done, and it was a good move there.
Yeah,
from Lee.
Velkov now coming down the straight. Where's Repussard? Just having a look, he's still in. He's just exiting the pits now. This is going to be close, but I think Peter's got him. He has, and in fact, he's gained a bit as well. 7 seconds. That pit stop was fantastic. Repussard, 9.4 seconds. So I'm wondering if these guys are taking a little bit more fuel than what Velkov has, and he's done his homework, or has he gonna made another mistake and just took 1 kilo too less and gonna run out of fuel? We've seen that this season.
I'm just gonna jump on board with the Aaron Lapchin as he's doing the lead. He's got a 6 second gap from Nenad now, and obviously Jan hasn't made a pit stop yet, so he could possibly be pitting any time soon. As he doesn't really want to lose his time, as Peter Velkov has been gaining ever so slightly. He hasn't really lost any positions from the pit stop phase so far from his competitors, so I'm just surprised Lapchin's still out there.
He's coming up to back markers now as well. I think that would have been the optimal time to duck in and avoid not getting slown up at all. Sorry there, Ryan. I think he's probably got about another lap before he gets on the back of Mullen, but no more than that. So let's see if he makes the call and comes in, or if he's going to just see if he can race on past them.
Yeah, I was just about to say, if I was the team principal of Jan Lapchin, I would just tell him, if you get ever closer to these two back markers than pits, because you're just going to be losing a lot of time behind these, and he's going to lose Peter Volkov, Repussard, and he could possibly lose out to Lopez here if he does not pit anytime soon. But it just really depends on how these bat markers play it, and if they let him go straight away, then Lapchin may not lose out. But if he stays in these two, then he's
Mullen
just going to be
2 seconds a lap slower that last time by, so I think he's going to get right on his tail with him. Although Lee Thompson in front is running almost similar lap times to what the leader is, so he's not going to catch up, but Mullen does the good thing, out the way.
Oh, no, there's been contact. Been a bit of contact, and I wonder if Lapchin's going to be...
Well, he's going to pit now. He'll get his free toe, but that has cost him dearly.
Yeah,
he's going really slow. I'm not sure what's going on there, but it's going to cost Wojciech as well. I'm guessing he must have some engine damage or something there, but it's disaster. You don't like to see that from... from overtaking a back marker, but nothing can be helped sometimes. It looked like Aaron got past, but Jan perhaps not. I don't know. It just looked like he just didn't get on the power or something there.
Yeah, it could possibly be that. I think he must have thought Aaron was out the way and stuff like that, but he was still there. And I think it's hard to say really, but. It's a real shame for Lapchin, as if he was going to be pitting that lap anyway, he could have possibly just jumped Peter Velkov. But it's a real shame, but that's racing for you. disappointing for Lapchin there.
I also wonder if Lapchin took it that one lap too far and run out of fuel.
Possibly.
It's always that possibility as well, but I can't tell. What I'll do, while we're just looking at this battle between Velkov and Repussard, very, very close, they've continued where they left off. You can see Lopez in the background. I'm just going to have a quick see if I can spool up a replay on board with Lapchin, just to see what happened there.
Just to say as well, Alex probably goes to the replay, and Nenad is in the pit lane. He's pitting now from the lead. And Paul Nielsen will take the lead unless he pits this lap as well. I think Paul's staying out for another lap, so Paul will take the lead of the race with just under 9 seconds. But we have a car in the pit lane. Is that Paul?
And we had contact there as well between these two battling. And actually, I think we might have lost. I think we might have lost Lapchin. It's contact again. How many more times is Velkov going to take a little pump from behind there? I'm amazed these guys are still going forward. And there's no damage on the front of the wing. Nenad there coming out.
Yep, and Velkov is he's doing well to keep Repussard behind him, to give him credit. But Repussard's right on the back of him. He could make a move here going towards the hairpin if he's still in the slipstream here. But I don't think he will. I think he's too far back to make an attempt of a move. But this has just been a brilliant battle between these two so far in this race. I'm just going to jump on board. Well, I'm going to look from the back of Peter Velkov now. As Repussard's ever getting ever closer, as he's in the slipstream, and as you said, this part of the track is the longest. Oh, and it's very close here. Repussard's right on the diffuser of Velkov here. Oh, this is good. And don't forget as well, Lopez is only 3 seconds behind the leader, so Lopez could be brought in here, but he hasn't got a lot of time left. He's only got around about 9 laps to go, so hopefully Lopez can catch up with these and possibly. And don't count Nenad as well, because he's only 3.5 seconds behind, and he was out of it early in the race, so Nenad's played the right decision of staying out slightly longer, and with the clean track as well as he had, he hasn't really lost any time here, so keeping out for Nenad as well, and also Paul as well, he's only 10 seconds off the lead as well.
Well, I just had a quick look at the replay back of that incident, no need to spoil it up, I think Jan thought he'd got himself passed, and I think Aaron had got Jan was all passed as well, and all of a sudden they come together. It was just purely a racing incident there. But why Jan slowed right down? I mean, didn't appear to have any engine damage, didn't appear to run out of fuel, just went really slowly, got himself in the pit lane, and I'm not even sure he's out of the pits now.
No, I think he's still in the pit lane. I think, Does he go back out again and get some points on the board, or does he decide to park the car up and call it a night?
Well, I have to wonder if he's fully aware that he gets one fast toe. I mean, he had a little bit of damage there. He could have drove back in the pits at full speed, lost himself about 2 seconds perhaps with that incident, got himself a nice shiny new Star Mazda, and out he goes again.
Yeah.
Very strange.
Just to point out as well, Lopez on the last lap was the quickest of the top three drivers here, and he's catching up by about 2-3 tenths of the lap, and he can see the two drivers in front of him. He's thinking, I couldn't be in with a chance of winning this race. From he was really not really on the pace at the start, but Lopez is slowly gaining. I'm just about to see how far he is now as he crosses the finish line. He gained 2 tenths on that lap there. He's now nearly 2 seconds behind Tony Repussard and Peter Velkov. And a thing to consider as well, Peter and Tony have a bat marker in front of them who came out the pit lane. I'm not entirely sure who it is, but I'll quickly jump on board with the leader.
Yeah, I think that was Aaron again, possibly. But we just saw actually Lapchin out as well, and he got well out of the way there, the bat marker, KTM driver.
Yep, and I think he will do the same now with Lopez. I'm liking this idea of Lopez here. He's going to get a bit of slipstream here to try and gain some time. As I think Repussard was trying to make a move on Velkov there, but can't really tell. Yeah, I'm just going to quickly jump on board with Tony Repussard.
Both drivers there having a little bit of the gravel. Oh, Peter, very, very sideways. Under a lot of pressure again, having to defend the line. this is what is helping Daniel out really here. You see, Peter's having to defend left, right, and centre everywhere to stop Tony getting a run on him. And that's costing both of these guys valuable time.
Oh my, oh, that was so close. Oh, we've got contact with Velkov. Was hit slightly by Repussard there. Lost the back of the car.
Yeah, he's moving over. Is he gonna?
Yeah.
He has indeed. Fantastic driving. Yes. That is what we like to see. Sportsmanship at its best. And that's what makes league racing so fantastic sometimes.
Yeah, that was brilliant sportsmanship there from Tony there. This is as you just said, this is what racing is about. If you don't see this anywhere else.
Lopez did catch up though with those guys doing that, and he's side by side now with Tony coming out of here. I think Tony's going to get the run though.
Yeah, I was about to say Tony has got the slipstream of Velkov here, so I don't think he's going to lose the place to Lopez, but Lopez could get an inside move done here, but he decides not to. But this has now become a three horse race now for the win with only 6 laps to go. And who's your money on, Alex?
I wouldn't like to call it at this point. Actually, it looks like Tony's got a tiny little bit of front wing damage, so the fact that he's keeping up with these guys with that tiny little bit of damage is pretty impressive. Let's see if he can stick with it. I mean, it might have been caused on that last lap, who knows.
Yep, and we've got a good battle going on for 8th place with John Allen and Colin here. Colin's only 6 tenths behind John.
Yeah, and John Allen, obviously Tony's teammate, so all good for the Constructors' Championship, especially with Jal and Marco Montaldo in 5th and 6th.
Yep, as the gap now between the top 3 is 8 tenths of a second, so Velkov is pulling away slowly, ever so slightly. Yeah, and I think I just saw Velkov or Repussard getting a bit of the back end loose here. And as you said, if these guys haven't pitted, their tyres are going to be really bad at this point, so it's whoever looks after these tyres the most here in these last 5 laps will win the race, in my opinion. And you don't really want to push this car to the limit and bottle it and lose the back end and crash out. So these guys are going to be trying to reduce traction coming out of these slow hairpin corners here. As a Repussard, look like he's going to make a move there, but he's close there, right on the back.
Repussard does look very good under the brakes going into that corner as well. I think if he can get a decent run coming out of the previous hairpin, then he will get the move done in that corner. But Peter defending extremely well and seems to be good in the first sector as well, which is what gives him that little bit of gap going into that back straight.
I'm just going to jump on board quickly off the top 3 here, and I'm going to jump on board with Paul Nielsen, who's now only half a second behind Marco here for 6th place. And as you can see, I've just jumped back onto the top 3, someone's pitting. I think it's Jan Lapchin who's back in the pit lane, I'm not sure. But Paul, he's having a good race so far. If he gets up to 6th place, it'll be a good finish for him and the team in particular. Also notable things as well, Justin's up into 10th place. I think he got past Liam Williams on that lap, I'm not sure. Other notable things as well, Aaron Mullins right on the back of Charlie Shears now for I think it's 13th place. And we have 4 laps to go. It's going to be very, very interesting here.
Yeah, these top 3, nothing separating them there. We're sort of keeping an eye on both the battles, but it looks like Paul's just lost a little bit of ground on Montaldo as well, so, and Rodriguez in front of him. So Rodriguez's move earlier on where he pitted early, that did pay out. He got past his teammate Marco and past Paul, I believe, as well. So that was a good move, got himself back up to 5th place. Nenad sitting on his own in 4th. Still be pretty happy with that result. Obviously fortunate to get top 4 with Jan and the back marker. But let's focus all our attention back on this battle for the lead, top 3, lap 27 of 31.
Ooh, and Repussard went a bit off-road there for a bit, and again, coming out of the final corner, but he hasn't really lost any time. As the gap now between these 3 drivers and that is 8 tenths of a second, and we only have 3 laps to go. Yeah, and this is going to be a very exciting 3 laps if it's going to stay like this. I think Peter has the slight advantage at the minute, as Repussard's going to be under pressure from Lopez. He's only four attempts behind, but
I think that's Peter's going to be sort of saving grace here. Really, is that Daniel had joined this battle, which gives Repussard something else to think about. He can't just lunge in and miss his breaking point and run up the inside and run wide, because he's going to lose the place himself. So anything he does has got to be absolutely pinpoint perfect.
Yeah, I'm just on board now with Velkov from the back of his rear, and it's so just great to see that this battle going on here, as he's gone a bit wide there. Not the ideal line he would take, but Repussard's ever so slightly gaining. You think he gained about a tenth, maybe possibly, on that lap, but Lopez is going even quicker than these two in front, and he's right on the back of Tony now. And the only advantage Lopez will have is he will have the double slipstream from these two cars, and he will gain, it's like a DRS like we have on F1, yeah, as you get more downforce and more straight line speed than these two in front of him. But the gap is Repussard's now two tenths behind, and Lopez there, as I've said, has gained advantage from that double slipstream. He's only now seven tenths behind Velkov, and two laps to go, Alex.
Yeah, Repussard a little bit wide there, and I think Daniel might get a bit of a run. This is going to be Daniel's best chance, I think, to be honest.
Yeah, and to be fair to Repussard, he's doing very well to defend from Daniel Lopez whilst trying to get past Velkov here.
Yeah, and don't forget, he's carrying that little bit of front wing damage. Well, we saw that while we were looking back from the gearbox of Velkov. It's not much, but it will be making just a little bit of difference. So fair play to him for keeping it in there. And talking about getting it in there, that was so, so close.
That is, this is amazing to watch. And Repussard just trying to do everything. He's given everything here with a broken end plate. Oh, this is, he's good. For me personally, I think he's going to be driver of the day for me, whatever happens. He's doing an absolutely brilliant, with a broken wing. Most people who have a broken wing would have lost the pace and just dropped from these drivers, but he's not. He's given it everything he's got. He's pushing the car to the limit, and he could still win as we're now approaching the penultimate lap of the race.
Yeah, this is where the pressure really mounts for Velkov. Two to go. There's nothing worse. Oh, he looked like he got a bit out of shape there as well. Tony, yeah. Going to have a look up the inside, around the outside maybe. Defending well from Velkov.
I think he could possibly
Lopez, maybe get a run.
Sorry, Alex, but Tony's going to try and make a move. He's going to the inside here. He's going to make the move stick. And is he going to do it? Oh, there's contact. Oh, that's a real shame. I thought Velkov could have given a bit more room there. Not entirely sure from what I saw I was on board with Repussard for that. And that's a real shame, that is.
We'll just, I think we'll just spool that one back up and have a look at that one again. Sure the viewers will want to see a second shot of that.
Yep, and Lopez now, he's thinking, as Velkov got damage up here, as Lopez is just jumping on board with him now in the cockpit view, and I think he's still got a chance here. He's just got to gain ever so slightly on here, but it all depends on if the leader has damage from that incident at the hairpin.
Just watching the replay now, Velkov didn't really cover the inside line. He turns in. I think he thinks for a minute there that Tony's not side by side. Who knows? We'll have to see how that one one pans out, but Tony will be a bit frustrated with that. I think he thought he had the move done. Here we come, last lap.
Yep, as Lopez is about half a second behind the leader, and I think these two are really struggling with these tyres now. They're just losing the back end every corner they go through, but I think Peter has the slight advantage here as
yeah,
the approach.
The damage that he picked up just seems to be fairly cosmetic, just a little bit of scuffing on the side pod there, so it doesn't seem to be affecting the car at all, straight line speed or anything like that. Daniel has got a little bit of a run, but I don't think he's going to get it done.
You can get close if he's going to try and do everything. He's going to push this car to the limit now to try and get close, and he is now. He's really pushing this car now. can he do it? I don't think he will, with a couple of corners to go. And he goes a bit wide, and I think that's it for him. He's not going to go for the win. He just went, a bit too aggressive coming out of that right-left chicane.
But yeah, give it everything. Still, though, he's still in the hunt. I think Velkov just eased off a little bit, and Lopez back on it. But here he comes. Peter Velkov, I called it. I'm so glad I didn't commentate curse him. But fantastic drive. Played the strategy right. Got himself in. His first victory of the season, well deserved. Daniel Lopez takes a very delighted P2 there as he weaves across, and Tony Repussard will come across in third place. He'll be perhaps a little bit disappointed, but still happy to get another podium. That cannot hurt his championship one bit. Nenad Matijevic, I think that was, behind him, coming across in fourth. It was indeed Jao Rodriguez, fifth. Montaldo, his Venezuelan teammate, in sixth. Those boys keep pumping in the points. I think with Repussard not winning all these races, they could find themselves competing back in this championship.
Oh, that was a brilliant race. That was it beats the V8 one that I was doing a couple of weeks ago. A cracking end to the race there. Lot of action. A real shame for Tony Repussard there with the contact with Peter Velkov, but That was brilliant. Probably the best race I've ever seen on iRacing, in my opinion.
I have to say, there's probably only one race that I've seen that would even compete with that, and that was at this track as well, Okayama. There's something about this track that always produces fantastic racing, and again, we've seen and been given a delightful one today. It's been a pleasure to commentate on it. And I wonder if you can just go through the final standings now that everybody's crossed the line.
Yep, and our race winner for the Okayama race was Peter Velkov, just pipping Daniel Lopez to second place, 6 tenths the difference was. Tony Repussard finishes in third place with Nenad, a strong performance for him, so he's my driver of the day, jumping from 10th to 4th place. Jao Rodriguez finishes in 5th, Marco in 6th, Paul Nielsen in 7th place with John Adder in 8th, Colin takes 9th, and Justin Lindsay in 10th place. Liam Williams in 11th, Rochek in 12th, with Charles Sears in 13th, Aaron McMullen in 14th, Lee Thompson in 15th, Jan Latch in 16th, and Yo in 17th to complete the resulting grid. And Alex, who's your driver of the day?
I think I'm going to give it to Peter. I mean, he didn't quite get pole position. He got him, you know, he got the move done, and soaked up a lot of pressure today. Decided to pit early, just so, let's hope he comes in for a little chat, actually. But I think he probably pitted early just to get away from some of that pressure and try and get out in front. And it worked. I mean, he got himself a couple of second lead, or about a second. But Tony fought back. Fantastic battle from them. And I just want to give Tony a bit of a shout out as well, because at the end of the day, he could have won that race. He got past, and sportsmanship outed, and he waited there after he made contact. And I just thought that was fantastic driving, and everybody should really take a little look at that and basically do the same thing again. It makes the admin's job so much easier when the position is just given back like that. So yeah, great driving there from Tony. But yeah, Peter Velkov, my driver of the day today for sure.
Yeah, I just want to give a shout to Nard as well. 10th place, really wasn't in it at the start, and then he played the smart strategy of staying out, and he's finished in 4th place. I think that's his best result of the season, I'm not entirely sure.
No, but it's a great fail miserably there, because he won last race, sorry. Get out. You had your chance, that's it. Big mistake,
yeah,
right at the end.
I'm off.
Get your jacket. Still a good result, and good points on the bounce again from Nenad. So, unfortunately, he's not going to have closed the gap on Tony, but Tony did recover the car really quickly, actually, and Nenad could have perhaps got him. But just having a quick look at the interview channel, actually, and we've got Charles Sears just waiting for an interview. And if any of the drivers have just quickly tuned in or anything like that, just feel free to jump in here. So we've got a few drivers in there, but get yourself in the interview channel, and we'll drag you up. But Charles is there. We'll just bring him up for a quick interview. Hi Charles, welcome back to the commentary box. Tell us a little bit about your race today, how it went.
Didn't go so well. I was doing pretty great in qualifying, and throughout practice I had some pretty good laps, and I was pretty consistently in really low 26s, so I thought a top 10 would be an easy finish for me here, just pick up some points and walk away. Then in the first lap, I got really close to Justin Lindsay, and his name starts with a W. I don't even want to try to pronounce it on air and have that recorded.
Wojcik,
maybe?
With him, yes, correct. And then going into turn four, I got a tap from one of them. I haven't watched the replay. I don't know who it was, but got a little tap, and then I just slid right across turn four and took out Lee Thompson. And I feel terrible about that because I think he's been taken out every single race so far.
Yeah, I think he has.
This is a real shame to see.
We were just hot lapping the whole race, so I could have done a lot better. I'm a little disappointed, but I mean, that's the nature of racing, right? You're not gonna make it out of first lap every time.
Oh, absolutely, sir. Absolutely. On to Watkins next week. How do we feel for that one?
I actually don't feel very good about that one at all. I'm gonna be at a conference, so I won't have my rig with me, but I will be racing just terribly slow, and I'm just gonna let people by if I'm terribly off pace, and if I'm really bad, I just might not show up. I don't wanna ruin anyone's race, but I mean, I'll do my best to be there.
That's commitment to the cause. That's what we like to see as well.
Yeah, hopefully I don't lose too much time there.
What I'm going to quickly do is I'm just going to drag your teammate up just so he can join you in this little interview. I'm not sure if you guys have had much time to have a chat since the race finished, but let's bring Colin. Hi, Colin.
You're right, Colin.
Hi.
Colin, how did your race go today?
Apart from my spin, it was not too bad, actually. Spin cost me about 9 seconds, I think, in total, and then I was just sort of angry after that, so better get myself back in the swing of it again. But yeah, perhaps without that spin, I probably would have been fine.
But did you and Charles, prior to the race, did you like get any strategies, team order style, plans sorted? Like,
We did plan, but obviously when I spun, then that sort of put all that out the window, and then it was just a case of trying to sort everything out from there.
We were just talking to Charles, obviously on to Watkins. He's going to struggle, obviously, away on the conference. What's your hopes for next week?
I don't know. I had quite high hopes for this week, so, and then it just gets dashed, so I'll just take it as it comes, I think.
Good idea.
Well, you were doing great this week until that spin. I mean, as long as you avoid incidents, you're going to do pretty awesome next week, I think.
See.
Well, thanks very much, fellas.
How about that?
Wish you all the best next week, and we look forward to seeing you on track.
Cheers, guys.
Thanks, chaps.
Well done, guys. Just if we can have a word with Liam and Justin, both Apex Racing.
What I want to do first is get Peter Velkov up here. Obviously, our race winner. He's just jumped into the channel, so let's drag him up.
Yeah. Cool.
Hello, Peter. Congratulations today. Fantastic race from you. Tell us a little bit about it and how you're feeling right now.
It was a race from the start to the finish. Very close. I'm completely smashed out right now. I think I have a fever.
I mean, how hard was it knowing that you have two very fast drivers in Lopez and Repussard behind you, and just keeping them behind? How was that in your mind?
Very tough, and it was much, much tougher than I thought. So, because here overtaking is very hard, but yeah. Tony was knocking on the door very often.
Yeah, we did see that, and we did see actually one time a little bit too hard, but he let you back go, which I thought was great sportsmanship. But one question I want to ask actually is, you pitted quite early compared to sort of the drivers around you. Was that strategical, or what was your thoughts behind that?
It was considered, yeah, but I had a little accident right before that, and I had to pit just to be sure. It felt a little not going straight. The wheel was pointing to the one side. Very tiny, but yeah, it can be very hard on the limit.
And obviously next week we're at Watkins, so how are you feeling going into that race?
I'm not gonna lie, I feel exhausted after today and I'll have to rest a lot and prepare.
Well, you fully deserve a nice pint, mate. You did an excellent job today and congratulations on your win.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, well done, Peter. I look forward to seeing you next week, buddy.
See you.
Right, let's just quickly grab the two teammates up as well.
Again, like...
Sorry, chaps, just grab you up here at the same time. I'm sorry, Justin, I caught you in mid-conversation there, didn't I, as well? So.
It's hard not to catch me in a mid-sentence.
Well, this is true, but we don't want to tell everyone what you're like on air. Tell us a little bit about your race, fellas. 10th and 11th? Perhaps not what you wanted today?
Would have liked to have been a bit higher. I wasn't too confident at this track, so... I had a fun race, though, especially last few laps. It was a good little battle.
And Justin, how do you feel your race went today?
Below average. Yeah, well, below, yeah, definitely not well. I unfortunately had real life things to do this morning, and all the practice that I had done leading up to this sadly was just goofing around and doing qualifying stuff, not really paying attention to the tire wear and just how things would progress. I could have done better. My qualifying, unfortunately, I couldn't start until about halfway through because, again, real life. And then when I did, I had a hot lap that was impeded by another driver. So I basically had a shot before that, but the setup was all wrong, and so I went back. My qualifying wasn't ruined because of that one incident, but that sure as heck didn't help when I finally got the setup on, and there was 3 minutes. And the race went pretty much well enough. I wanted to make sure that I was in front of the people that I wanted to make sure that would prevent me from getting in front of them on lap one. So I wish I could have held on better to John. I was doing great behind him because it was just easy just to kind of follow him, and then afterwards I had not much to look at but my Delta screen and just went to pot from there, unfortunately.
10th place again though, so you racked up some points again. I guess that's the most important thing, just keep plugging away for the championship, and a team keeps getting points. You're slowly working your way back up there, guys, as well. So, you know, we're not quite at the halfway stage of the season. Obviously, we've got a lot of tracks unannounced. You know, Watkins Glen next. How do we feel about that? And what do we want to see in the next few rounds coming up?
Well, there'll be Interlagos this coming late winter or late summer for the Australians, I suppose, and New Zealanders, if there's any.
Yeah, I can pretty much guarantee that will be on the schedule.
That's good. Looking forward to Watkins. I've always enjoyed Watkins Glen. And I do feel a lot more confident with the car recently. So I reckon I can get more points and move my way up. Hopefully ahead of Justin.
Nice to see there's a bit of team rivalry going on there.
I've got hell to pay if I'm right behind him, unfortunately, I feel.
Well, what?
Yeah, it was.
Sorry, carry on, Justin.
I was just gonna say, I wish we had been, you know, at the very worst, 10th and 9th, so that way both of us were in. Because when he was right behind me, I wanted to make sure that I didn't lose, you know, the car by going into first gear to, you know, and snap it around too much, and then take him with me, and then we're both losers. And that, so I was overly cautious, and I.
Nope, we just lost Justin.
Yeah.
Oh, and he's back, sorry.
just like the race, I had a mistake and hit the wrong button there. So yeah, it happens all the time.
Well, just well done again, lads. I mean, 10th and 11th in that field is nothing to, you know, to be disappointed with. I mean, it was ridiculously close in qualifying, and like I said, you're working your way up there, so we look forward to watching your progress throughout the rest of this championship.
Thank you.
Right, well, that just about wraps up the coverage of today. I just want to say thank you, Ryan, again, for jumping up and filling the boots. Hope you're going to be a bit more of a regular. Apart from epic fail with Nenad, I think it went fantastically.
Oh, yeah. Apart from that, yeah, I really enjoyed tonight. It's probably, as I've said in the actual race, it's probably the best race I've ever seen on any racing game that I've ever, like, online racing. So, fair credit to all the guys taking part tonight. It was a really good race, and one I'll be watching over and over again.
Yeah, fantastic race, and what I haven't done before this point was give a shout out to the sponsors, so let's do that now as we come to a close. So thank you to Apex Racing League. They're the guys that host this, pay for that, and have basically arranged all the prizes and things like that these drivers are competing for. So, you know, big thanks to the whole moderating team there. Without you guys, it wouldn't go on. Let's not forget iRacing as well. We obviously put this fantastic service on. GT Omega Racing, who have put up wheel stands and racing cockpits for us. And Sim News Daily as well, who give us a little bit of a plug and push our championships and things like that. So Alistair there, if you haven't been on to his site, then take a look, simnewsdaily.com. All the latest Sim News is up to date on there. But on that note, I'm going to wrap it up and call it a night, and wish everyone a farewell, and see you all next week for Watkins Glen.
Take your hobby to the next level with a quality racing rig that works great with a PS3, Xbox 360, and a PC. Omega Racing Simulator is compatible with a wide range of steering wheels, including Logitech, Fanatic, Thrustmaster, and more. The GT Omega is available now worldwide by going to www.gtomegaracing.com.
Creating a new NASCAR sanctioned series, a new division of NASCAR that people from all over the world can compete in from their homes.
They're all just fans really wanting to know and to be able to get as close to the realism of driving a race car as possible. And there's nothing really that catches it quite like iRacing.
It can be a tool for guys that don't have a lot of experience at a track or don't, have never been somewhere. You can crash a lot. It doesn't hurt, doesn't cost you a lot of money. And you can get an idea of what's going on before you ever get to the racetrack.
To the Indianapolis